Weidenfeld and Nicholson presents Cristiano Ronaldo, written by Guillem Balague. Read by Peter Kenny. Prologue. What we are, where we are, where we are going. News is circulating that I allegedly made offending remarks regarding Lionel Messi. This is absolutely false, and I have assured my lawyer takes action to sue those responsible. I have the utmost respect for all my professional colleagues, and Messi is obviously no exception. Cristiano Ronaldo, on Facebook, 11th of November, 2014. Ronaldo, or whoever writes his Facebook content, was referring to statements of his that I had included in my book entitled Messi, Orion 2013, the first authorized biography of the Argentinian footballer. When I found out about his reaction on Twitter, I decided to take a step back. Clearly, there was going to be uproar. According to Manu Sainz, a journalist who was Ronaldo's spokesperson over those controversial days, the Portuguese's anger while on international duty with his country was rife, and the player wanted to respond as soon as possible in the most public way. Had he not done so, the accusation, defamation or comment, depending on how you viewed it, could have gone unnoticed. Ronaldo was attempting to crack a nut with a sledgehammer, and did so by sending the above message to his 100 million followers. Why? He would be crossing paths with Messi in a friendly match in Manchester in the coming days. He could meet him face to face and deny the allegation. My allegation. The story I was told by people very close to Cristiano. In reality, the offending paragraph had been in the public domain for 11 months. Why was there such a dramatic reaction almost a year after the publication of his rival's biography? That week, with no domestic matches to report on and only international games, the Daily Telegraph chose to publish two extracts from the paperback edition of Messi, which had just been published. In fact, the English daily newspaper selected two excerpts already featured in the hardback 11 months earlier: Arsenal's attempt to sign Leo and the relationship between Messi and Ronaldo, and it all kicked off. The media, initially in Spain, but then the social networks got hold of it and it quickly spread to all corners of the globe, grabbed hold of one word, took it out of context, twisted it, and in Spain translated it incorrectly. Could that word define the most distinguished rivalry in the history of football? My career was judged and debate ensued over whether or not such things are said in a dressing room full of adrenaline-infused warriors. The word was motherfucker. This is how I said Ronaldo referred to the flea in front of his teammates in the dressing room. By that point, I had already begun research on my next book, this one. I had spoken to Cristiano regarding the possibility of chatting about his life, his way of thinking, his past. Yes, of course, no problem, he told me, on four separate occasions. I had also conversed with his agent, Jorge Mendes, who agreed to collaborate just 10 days before that Facebook post, although both of us questioned whether or not it was a good idea. I will explain why later. I went to the Derbyshire Peak District in order to take advantage of the international break. While out jogging, I could not stop asking myself what made him respond in that way. Was a legal threat necessary? Other people are better suited to such conflicts than me. Johan Cruyff used to say that he wanted to know where the line separating those who loved him and hated him lay, just so he would know who to fight against. Frank Rijkaard once told me that he would feel awful if he found out that even one person hated him. I know what you mean, Frank. I spent plenty of time around the English countryside over those days. I started focusing on the colours, aromas, the sound of the branches cracking. But all that was blurred by the new questions swirling around my head. What can we learn about Ronaldo if we study his reaction? Was I changing my perception of him and my desire to study him? What would happen to the collaboration that had been discussed? For a start, I was unaware that my influence was such as to prompt him to react with such opprobrium. The media circus had gone to town. It was another one of those storms that surge when the names Messi and Ronaldo are uttered in the same sentence, especially during an international break with the resultant paucity of football news. What else was happening at the time for him to feel compelled to write such a message? There had to be more to it, something that set his alarm bells ringing. It finally hit me sometime later. There were 10 days to go before voting for the Ballon d'Or closed, an award that Ronaldo was the favourite to win for the third time. Surely his Facebook post was not just a way to prevent people from changing their vote in that year's Ballon d'Or. Or was it? And what to say about the media's reaction? The subject became big news and received what I consider disproportionate coverage in sports sections in newspapers and on the radio, especially in Spain. On the very night of Ronaldo's post, I spoke about the issue on Onda Cero, the radio station I work for. I did not want to do it. I wanted the Messi book to speak for itself. But I had just been involved in an interview with Real Sociedad president Joachim Aperibay for the radio program Al Primer Toque, and the presenter, Hector Fernandez, to whom I still owe various favours, convinced me to say something, whatever it might be. I came out with what I have repeated ever since. It's all in the book. This is what you can read in Messi. Ronaldo, perhaps as a symptom of the immaturity that marks so many footballers, thinks it necessary to put on a brave face in front of his teammates, not be scared of Messi, and to rise to the challenge. All very macho, very false. And that is why, according to some Real Madrid players, CR7 has a nickname for him, Motherfucker. And if he sees someone from the club speaking to Leo, he also ends up being baptized Motherfucker. In that environment, Ronaldo usually compares their relationship with that between the Republic of Ireland and the United Kingdom. And the Madrid players, with their less than subtle dressing room sense of humour, have a long list of jokes that include Messi as Ronaldo's dog or puppet, or kept in a designer handbag belonging to the Portuguese player, and much worse. It became clear that not many people had actually read the book, nor did any of them find the time to seek out and analyse the paragraph concerned until I posted it on Twitter on the night of the Facebook post. All that says little in favour of my weight in the Spanish media circus. Almost nobody felt compelled to read my book, even though it was the first authorised one of the flea. It also reflects the speed with which news is generated and consumed. On returning to reality after my isolation in the Peak District, I began going over the various reactions. A man whom I admire dearly, Paco González, had given me a rap on the knuckles on his programme on Cope Radio. He stated that there are things that need not be told, dressing room talk that should remain there. But part of his own success, aside from being a marvellous communicator, is the way in which he manages the information that reaches him from the dressing room. A handful of journalists performed the selfless role of Ronaldistas, defending the player in the face of accusations because that is what their job consists of, being a transmission chain for the footballer. It was not pleasant to be put under the microscope, but it gave me some idea of what players experience when they are judged by supporters for 90 minutes once or twice a week, and then again the next day by the media, relentlessly. Did it make sense to include that word, that paragraph, that dressing room chit-chat in the Messi book? A year-long piece of work involving hundreds of hours of conversations and thoughts assembled in 600 pages about the flea had turned into controversy because of one word. Did it prove it? Did it add much to Leo's story? Maybe it did not contribute much. In reality, it said more about Ronaldo than it did about Messi, about the Portuguese's need to show off to his peers. Maybe I should have left it out. But essentially, had I done anything wrong? That last question did have an answer. Everything that I publish is checked thoroughly, especially on a subject such as this one, especially in a biography. Furthermore, all books are scrutinised by the publisher's lawyers. The context, which was and continues to be ignored, was crucial. Ronaldo and Messi respect each other because of their similar footballing paths. They mix respect with feelings that you have for your nemesis, but, importantly, they react to each other's success differently. Cristiano is a warrior from the moment he leaves his home, when he gets dressed, speaks or behaves like a player. He is afraid of no one. Plus, he can show no sign of weakness. On the contrary, while I repeatedly mulled over the situation, Everyone else was focusing on breaking other news. Sergio Ramos had said something or other about certain Spanish internationals' commitment. The message was implicitly understood as a jibe at Cesc Fabregas and Diego Costa, who had withdrawn from Vicente del Bosque's latest Spain squad. One controversial story was replaced by another. 48 hours in the eye of a hurricane. Only 48, but it seemed much longer. One question remained fixed in my head. Does the truth save you? I could not stop thinking about the role of sports journalism, both in England and Spain, the two countries where I know it well. As sports writers, we only tell a portion of what we know. In fact, there are almost always two conversations with our sources or interviewees, one with the microphone on and another with it off. Many stories are known, but do not come out for a plethora of reasons, be they good, insufficient sources waiting for the right moment, or bad, so as not to annoy a friend, lose a source, or the fear of isolation that always accompanies breaking an exclusive. Only part of the truth is told. Whatever we think will be of interest, or whatever we think will sell best. One can, or rather one must, be accurate, fair, and unbiased when it comes to data. The way a story is presented and treated must be honourable. But being objective is an impossibility from the moment one word is chosen over another to describe something. We are answerable to an ethical code, of course, and to our bosses, now more so than ever, now that work is so precarious. The person who pays calls the shots. In fact, the person who pays defines the parameters of what is and is not true, and information is bought and sold because it is now no more than a product, and even more so in the showbiz world of professional football. Plus, very powerful people make huge efforts to ensure they can influence what is written. I know that an important club president in Spain tried, unsuccessfully, to get the head of a major sports newspaper sacked for not sharing his ideas, in a ploy to prevent criticism. He used personal accusations and other pressure tactics in his attempt. I shall not reveal who was involved. I will only tell you half the story for the time being. You see, journalism is not simply a recounting of events. During an appearance of journalist Manu Sainz on the television show El Chiringuito de Jogones, he spoke about his relationship with Ronaldo just after the player was sent off for aggressive conduct against Córdoba in La Liga. Cristiano is exemplary, even when he makes a mistake. The other day, he was on the team bus minutes after the match against Córdoba, and he told me, "I want you to write a few things for me. I haven't had time to apologise and want you to write something." I was going to do it, but I did not because the club later said it was better to do it on Twitter. Write things on behalf of a player. Some people were incensed. Some labelled it terrible journalism. "Manu is just Ronaldo's scribe," retorted others. That is, however, the reality of how a large part of the industry works. A certain level of submission is exchanged for information. What I had never previously heard so clearly was the "he gave me a few sentences to write down" concept. In England, many journalists also defend coaches or players because they are friends. I shall not reveal who. I have a soft spot for Rafa Benitez. I've seen him take training and how he works. I know many of the reasons behind his decisions and his way of thinking. I defend him over and above my journalistic duties because I feel that he is unfairly treated. There is a sort of crusade behind my statements about Rafa, who was not helped by the way he disrupted the status quo in the Premier League with his challenging of Sir Alex Ferguson, Manchester United, referees, the FA, even José Mourinho. I also thought if he were English, he would be a national hero. But is that journalism? Is that intellectual corruption, or are we the consequence of how the industry is set up? I, for one, will never be able to, nor shall I try, to be objective when it comes to Cristiano Ronaldo. But I promise the following. Read on. You may be familiar with Oliver Sacks, perhaps the most famous professor of neurology of the 20th century, physician, best-selling author, and chronic introvert. He was curious about the world and our minds, but unable to have meaningful conversations or relationships with most people, as he explained in his beautiful autobiography, On the Move. Sometimes, though, he would be so astonished by the thrill of observation and could not help sharing. I almost never speak to people in the street, but some years ago there was a lunar eclipse, and I went outside to view it with my little 20x telescope. Everyone else on the busy sidewalk seemed oblivious to the extraordinary celestial happening above them, so I stopped people saying, "Look, look what's happening to the moon," and pressing my telescope into their hands. People were taken aback at being approached in this way, but intrigued by my manifestly innocent enthusiasm, they raised the telescope to their eyes, wowed, and handed it back. "Hey man, thanks for letting me look at that," or "Gee, thanks for showing me." I don't promise objectivity, but a total commitment to the curiosity that we all have for a life like Ronaldo's, and especially his journey. There is another issue that can endanger the relationship with the subject of a biography. Let us imagine that I convinced Cristiano to sit down and tell me how he has got where he is using new words, unknown stories, and the required sincerity. Maybe he would say, "I may seem arrogant, but I'm not because of this, that, and the other." Or maybe he would admit that he is, but refuse to accept others judging him. Maybe he would say that he wants everyone to love him. Maybe he would say that he does not fancy going to work in the morning, or that sometimes he doesn't enjoy playing football. But who is capable of being so brutal, open, and sincere? We all have black marks, weaknesses, issues, thoughts which we are ashamed of, chapters from the past that we try to keep under wraps, and if they do come out, we cover them up, even more so if we are in the public eye. That is the limit which the biographer battles against. Interviewing the subject in question does not guarantee access to the whole truth. It guarantees the subject's truth. Furthermore, Cristiano Ronaldo has been the main protagonist in a crucial image campaign since 2012, when he realized that the world did not understand him. Jorge Mendes, the brains behind Justifuta, the most renowned agent in the football world, instigated the campaign. More doubts began circling in my head. Did I want to tell the Justifuta version of the Ronaldo story? Around that time, I went out for a bite to eat with a very famous player. He was a top star of a legendary team during a spell of historic title wins, and now earns his living as a coach. He has been in the business for over 30 years. "You know you can't tell the truth, right?" he told me, while discussing the limits of the exercise that I had undertaken. "They will want to control you. It is only normal that they would do that." I had missed a call on my mobile phone from an unfamiliar Portuguese number, 2 weeks before the whole Facebook saga. Could it have been Jorge Mendes? I had been trying to see him since the previous Christmas, which I had spent in Dubai after accepting his invitation to the Globe Awards, which he has been organizing for 7 years. This is an event to celebrate the success of the Mendes Empire. In the one I attended, Deco, who was represented by the Portuguese agent, won the Player of the Decade Award, while Xavi Hernandez, who was offered an all-expenses-paid trip to Dubai for a few days with his family, received the award for Best Player over the last 10 years. Seriously, the titles of the awards change depending on who is in attendance, but the networking is of the highest caliber, as you would expect. I only had a Spanish number for Mendes, who spends most of his time in Madrid, and, as I say, had been waiting for his call since that Christmas. We had exchanged a few messages, and it seemed that the definitive conversation, which would determine our relationship in the subsequent 12 months when I would be writing the book, was about to take place. From the moment the Real Madrid Communications Department directed my requests to interview President Florentino Perez and the players to Mendes, and when I was told that in order to arrange a chat with Ronaldo, I had to speak to his agent, I knew that everything would be decided during a difficult and possibly one-off phone call. Mendes does not beat about the bush. There are no pauses in his conversations. Bang, 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 and that is it. That is how you speak to Mendes. Or, more like, how he speaks to you. I had already been to Funchal, Madeira, and Lisbon. I had spoken to Real Madrid players. I had spent time in Manchester and shared long conversations with many people who were part of Cristiano's life. I had plenty of information. My experience with Ronaldo, interviewing him for Sky Sports, presenting some of his commercial events, added something extra. I could do the book with the information already available to me. but I remained determined to speak to Mendez, despite the doubts about the expected fight for control of what would be written. "Speak to people who know me, Georges. You'll find out what type of writer and person I am. I'm not after an authorized book, but we could chat and you could come with me on this journey." I was sending him text messages of that ilk. I was receiving either negative responses or silence. As part of my research, I read a biography of Ronaldo by Mario Torrejon, a colleague on Ser Radio, who collaborated with Mendez. Mario, who communicates his ideas very well in what is his first book, was able to interview the agent, Ronaldo, and the Real Madrid president. I feel he did have to pay a price, however. It seems to me that many of the stories told in that biography have the Justifuta stamp on them. I called the Portuguese number back. I thought that, if it was Mendez, I would see where the conversation took me without committing to anything. It was Mendez. "Look," he told me, without first exchanging pleasantries, "I've decided I'm going to help you, but don't screw with me. I've spoken to people who tell me you're a good guy." I later found out that Mendez had asked, among others, Marca director Oscar Campillo for reports and was given glowing references. "The problem is, I don't know what you're going to write. You've done the Messi book. With Mario, Torrejon, we knew what he wanted to do and what he was writing from the first minute. I don't really know how I can help you. I want to help you, but I don't really know how." In the very first minute, we were heading down a dead-end street. It was now a battle for the upper hand. "I don't know what you're going to write. I don't know who you're going to speak to." "Do you want to know who I'm speaking to? I can tell you." "No, you can do whatever you want." "But everybody tells me to speak to you. The club should take greater responsibility, but I don't know if we'll speak because I don't know what you're doing and what you're going to write." "We can sit down and talk it over. I'll tell you the angles I'm covering." I explained to him that, before knowing what I was going to write, I had to do a few more interviews, and the format of the book would start to take shape a few months down the line. That was not entirely true, but it gained me some time, in case I needed it, to finally reach an agreement with him. Ronaldo's entourage has understood that, in order to keep him happy, and also to feed the competitive beast that he is, he must be given absolute guarantees that everybody and everything, sporting institutions included, are at his service. They must keep criticism at a distance, or control it, create the narrative, and keep him on his pedestal. That helps him win more Ballon d'Or and trophies. It is good for business, too. One question remained unanswered. What happens if we disagree on something? "We'll discuss it," he told me. I thought, let's take Ronaldo's transfer to Real Madrid, for example. I know what took place. I have seen the contracts. But what if Mendez does not want to explain the whole saga, including the offer he got from Manchester City that he seemed happy to consider? How can we explain, from Ronaldo's point of view, the story of him taking the only locker opposite a mirror in the Manchester United dressing room? Is it treated as a triviality or a reflection of a vain personality? Can we discuss narcissism? Would they let me analyze the presence and absence of an alcoholic father who refused help towards the end of his life? "Just so you know," insisted Mendez, "this is fully my responsibility. Some people in my camp are telling me not to work with you, but I understand that you're a decent guy and we're going to work together. We're going to do this together, but you can't screw me." We could not get away from that. He was telling me that he did not know how to help me because he did not know how to control me. I was offering him a certain level of supervision, but not complete. I have not spoken to Mendez since the Facebook controversy. In fact, after the Facebook post, Mendez made a few calls to the opinion makers of the Spanish media. If Ronaldo is upset, Mendez multiplies it by 20. He wanted his friends in the media to deny the story, but also to question my credibility. Portugal and Argentina met in a friendly at Old Trafford on the 18th of November 2014. The build-up to the game centered around the relationship between Ronaldo and Messi. Plenty was written about their relationship, and every now and then the infamous word from my book was mentioned. It had been taken out of context, planted somewhere else, and allowed to grow. I had planned to go to Manchester, but did not want to bump into either player. I could imagine Ronaldo ignoring me in front of my colleagues when, previously, he would have stopped to say hello and chat. I could imagine Messi shaking my hand, talking to me as he sometimes does. That would be enough, I thought, for somebody to reignite the story. Why open another potential can of worms? I was also aware that the situation was probably not that serious, but my sensitivity had increased, as had my paranoia. The Facebook post ended the debate with Mendez about controlling the content of this book, and I genuinely felt an overwhelming sense of freedom. For Real Madrid, Mendez or Ronaldo's version, there are official books or ones in which they have collaborated. I prefer not to participate in the construction of that legend, but in truth, I have no other choice. What you will read here is my version of Ronaldo's journey, what has influenced him, which Madeiran traits remain with him, how he developed at Manchester United, and what Real Madrid have done for him. I will discuss his arrogance and vanity, which will constitute the debate over whether or not his battle to be the best requires those two elements. Why does he feel the need to be acknowledged as the best, and constantly so? What drives him? Why does he work so much harder than anybody else? While thinking about his addiction to his job and self-improvement, I read a magnificent Marco Ruiz interview in AS with Arrigo Sacchi, AC Milan's legendary coach from the 80s. Your players speak highly of you, but they say he was a workaholic. There's an Italian poet who used to say, there's no art without obsession. If you don't put much in, you don't get much back. In his book, Carlo Ancelotti said, Arrigo was so determined and convinced that we said, we have to carry on. It was almost a matter of fanaticism. I saw that quality in all great coaches. Lobanovsky, Michels, Guardiola, Kovac. They gave everything they could give. I retired after 20 years of hard work. I couldn't cope with that pace. I was spent. Only one certainty drove me, that you could always do better. My Milan side won the European Cup, European Super Cup, and International Cup in the space of a few months. Barisi said to me, now we're the best in the world. I answered him, yes, until midnight tonight. These are also the qualities that make Ronaldo who he is. There are more Cristianos than the obsessive one. Take the cocky and generous one, for example, the one who has evolved on the pitch, the one who made himself, the one who was alone as a teenager, the one who protects his family, becoming a rock in the process, the one who celebrates his work in controversial ways, the one who gives away his bonuses. I travelled far and wide to discover as many angles as possible. However, I discovered a certain level of mistrust in Madeira and Portugal in general when it came to discussing Ronaldo or Mendes. Why so afraid? Why is the only possible relationship with either of them a submissive one? Would it be possible to explore all of this if the final version had to be signed off by Jorge Mendes? I discovered that a fascinating culture shock had taken place at the Carrington training ground in Manchester. Many people were part of the creation of Ronaldo, or so they say, and many others wanted to change him as they did not believe he would become half the player he is today. Some even lost faith in him, given his obsession with individual play over the requirements of the team. Maybe they did eventually change him, but not all of them would admit that Cristiano also transformed the culture of one of the most famous footballing institutions in the world. It was going to take some scraping away to remove the layers of paint that cover the Ronaldo that his circle is trying to sell to the world nowadays, while remaining conscious of human strengths and weaknesses. Will my version be better than others? The truth is, it does not matter. One thing is for sure, though. I will try to make it different. Everybody takes photographs of the Eiffel Tower, but the key lies in taking the one that nobody has seen before. Maybe it will not be the Ronaldo that you all want to see, or the Ronaldo that he wants you to see, or the Ronaldo that Mendes wants to portray, or even the Ronaldo that he really is, or the Ronaldo that his critics know so well. What follows is based on research, analysis, studies, 25 years of journalistic experience, on chats with people who know him, psychologists, sociologists, players with whom he has shared the dressing room, club directors, some of his coaches, as well as conversations that I had with him and his circle before the controversy, both on and off the record. Ronaldo has let the world explore his life. He often offers interviews and lets the cameras in behind the scenes at trophy presentations. CNN were granted open access to his home for a chat in 2012, and so on. That is how the image of a winner is gradually created. It will not be easy to find the real person. By the way, for those who wonder, no, I never did get a call from Ronaldo's lawyers. Chapter 1. Madeira. A small island like all the others. When we are born, we are the consequence of four elements of which we have no choice: our mother, our father, our siblings, and the place we are born. What else is there? Our passion, what motivates us. After that, we only have the superfluous, the decorative. I know you will not all agree. While we wait to see what drives an unborn Cristiano Ronaldo, who deserves the first pages? The mother, the family, or the place where he was born? What should we write about first? Dolores Aveiro is the mother who still lives alongside Cristiano and who looks after his son as if she were his mother rather than his grandmother. She is also the woman who let her 12-year-old son leave home in order to pursue his dream of becoming a footballer. It hurt, but she did let him go at such a young age, maybe because it was the best option or the only one, or maybe because something similar happened to her. It is often said that in life lessons, virtues and defects are repeated from generation to generation. Dolores's father walked out on her, although he did it in a different way, without the kindness that she packed into Cristiano's suitcase when he flew to Lisbon. I get the impression that there is an invisible thread linking both experiences. Anyway, you simply cannot understand Ronaldo without going through Dolores's life. We need to set the scene by pinpointing the place where Dolores and Cristiano were born, grew up, and from where they eventually escaped. We need to go to Funchal. Funchal is the capital of the Portuguese island of Madeira, off the northwest coast of Africa. The extremely verdant island is filled with the spirits of departed inhabitants and present-day residents on the verge of departing. A prison without doors, a crossroads, a springboard, and it was discovered by accident. Let us go back to the beginning of the Age of Discovery in the early 15th century. Henry the Navigator, Infante of Portugal, and the first Duke of Viseu moved around the Portuguese king's court with freedom. Henry, the son, brother, and uncle of monarchs, had hooded eyes, but a determined voice, and skillfully obtained the monopoly over the exploration of the African coast. He put together the best navigators and cartographers in the country, and by definition in the world at the time. He sent them to discover new lands with square riggers, three masts and limited resources, an astrolabe, an hourglass, and a compass. Little else. The winds off the African coast were treacherous and new to the young captains, João Gonçalves Zarco and Tristão Vaz Teixeira, who lost their way. Days went by without any sight of land, before the discovery of a small island with golden beaches that they named Porto Santo. Having charted the waters, the navigators returned to Portugal to report on their findings. "Thank you," said Infante Henrique. "Now go back and colonize the island. Keep looking for new horizons too." It was the year 1419. Back in the area, not very far from Porto Santo, towards the south, the explorers witnessed a vast cloud formation that anyone who has been to Madeira knows is as characteristic of the island as its steep roads and wine. Every nautical mile into unexplored waters was a step into the unknown, a repudiation of superstition and fear. They had to battle against the Atlantic waves and the harsh weather conditions to get from Porto Santo to the Bay of Machico, the gateway to Madeira. The navigators finally dropped anchor on the biggest of the four islands in the volcanic archipelago, 400 kilometers from the Canary Islands, and located on the same latitude as Casablanca, Morocco. They left the small and unpopulated Desertas and Savage Islands, both current World Heritage Sites, for a later date. Madeira was discovered. Henry the Navigator sent families, principally farmers, from the Algarve to colonize the new land soon after. There are almost 270,000 people living there today. The Portuguese Empire was formally dissolved in 1975, with Madeira remaining as a trace of that golden era, but also a distant cousin the family back in Portugal struggles to accept. I stopped off in Lisbon ahead of my first trip to Funchal. I went out for dinner with some friends at Clube de Journalistes, a venue that one might imagine is a breeding ground for intellectual and sensitive discussion. Not when it comes to Madeira. The Madeiran people, they informed us, not only have a strange accent, but they are strange too. I imagine you've heard about the latest paedophilia scandal over there and the poverty swamping the island. It's a small dictatorship with the longest-standing leader in the country. It's not Portugal, it's something else. And the tourist area? For lower-class English people, we were told by a man who continued to volunteer such details, despite the fact he had never set foot on Madeira. Nor did he need to, he said. After landing at the tiny airport in Funchal, I noticed that the statue of Zarco still stood in the town centre, looking over the descendants of the families from the Algarve, who, 6 centuries earlier, colonised the island of dense volcanic rock. And, as the explorers had found, we were welcomed by low-lying clouds that you could almost touch, fulsome and round, reminiscent of a painting by John Constable. As it was May, at the close of another exhausting football season, my visit to Madeira was intended for relaxation purposes, as well as making contact with people linked to the main protagonist of my new book. I looked for a good hotel and a rental car, without knowing quite how big an engine was needed to comfortably negotiate the steep roads with more than a 30-degree gradient. I plunged myself into Funchal and went on the hunt for my first sources of information. I interviewed some renowned local journalists who painted a surprising picture of Ronaldo, who seemed distant whenever he went back to Funchal, had forgotten Madeira, according to them, and had little interest in what he had left behind. It reminded me of what they say about the Beatles in Liverpool. It hurts Liverpudlians that John, Ringo, George and Paul never felt grateful to the city in which they were born. There was more. Ronaldo had gone into business with some very affluent people who tried to take advantage of him by asking him for money without keeping to the promises that had been made. Meanwhile, they told me, Cristiano had become very friendly with the island's ruling clique, one of the guaranteed ways to be looked after on the island. Let us put this into context. The former president of the autonomous region of Madeira, Alberto João Jardim, enjoyed 37 years in power before tendering his resignation in January 2015. A fine politician, benefactor and leader for the Madeiran cause for some, the perfect representative of the establishment for the rest. During his farewell speech to journalists on the day he left office, he said, "I didn't plan to hurt anyone, but if someone is unfair to me, they'll pay for it." Jardim, who was surrounded by associates with more power than sense, was a man with whom you needed to be on good terms. An initial glance reveals 2 types of Madeiran, those like Jardim, for whom Madeira is the world, and those like Zarco, the founding father, who left to conquer new worlds, although he kept a house on the island. The fact is that no Madeiran ever truly leaves. The first settlers worked the land, and even today, cultivating smallholdings is the biggest economic activity on the island. There were many bad harvests, however, and the land had to be split up to cope with the growing number of inhabitants, making survival much more difficult. People had to emigrate, though most did so in the hope of returning someday. Being a tiny island at the crossroads of Europe, America and Africa, the big continents beckon. That is why large communities of Madeiran people grew in places as far away as South Africa and Venezuela, with most of them quickly becoming leading figures in their professions soon after landing in their new territories. Builders, factory workers, lawyers or hotel and catering entrepreneurs. There is no point leaving your homeland unless it is to conquer another world. Now, 750,000 self-proclaimed Madeirans spread across the globe like to boast about their origins. Does it not remind you of Ronaldo? On that first journey to Cristiano's homeland, I had time to wander around the area where he was born, the humble Quinta do Falcão. Built into a mountainside and defined by 2 steep roads, modest housing, clothes drying outside the windows, 1 lone shop and a bar with a plastic roof and a raised terrace situated on a block of uneven cement. Cristiano's house was demolished less than 10 years ago in order to build more council houses. Grants from the European Union have allowed for an increase in prosperity in the area, but Although the autonomous government wants to hide it, the island is actually floating on a sea of economic inequality. The autonomous government speaks of only about 2% living below the poverty line in a bid to protect tourism, while the charitable organization União das IPSS puts the figure at 20%. Unemployment is widespread, and state benefits do not reach everybody. More than 28,000 citizens must rely on the authorities for subsidized food. The very wealthy, meanwhile, comprise 10% of the population. The turn of the century generated an interesting transformation. Madeira has been closely linked to the United Kingdom since the 17th century, when it became a port of call for British traders on their long transatlantic journeys. British soldiers even occupied Madeira on a couple of occasions during the Napoleonic Wars to prevent the French from colonizing it. Some decided to set up shop on the island in order to begin developing farms and the wine trade. During the Victorian age, ladies with unmistakably British surnames such as Blandy and Laycock would spend the mornings drinking Madeiran wines and the afternoons sipping tea in the salons of their luxurious mansions. The Second World War signalled the beginning of the end of British influence and the strategic importance of the port. The new generations, facing economic decline, sold the residences that had been homes to their families for centuries and returned to the United Kingdom. Barely 200 British residents remain, but the idea persists among Madeiran inhabitants, or even the Portuguese in general, that the British lifestyle represents an enviable and better way of life. So, after three centuries under British rule, the colonial style was replaced by a new generation of businessmen. They were descendants of Portuguese expatriates who had made their money in South Africa or Venezuela. This group, families like the Pestanas, the Roques, the Barrados, continued to consolidate their wealth and set about improving the island's infrastructure and stabilizing the unsteady economy. From the top of the hill where my hotel is located, you can see some spectacular residences, but also the huts built in the gaps left by the mountain, half-built houses on dry wasteland and rubbish on the street, and many tired-looking elderly people wandering around aimlessly. On the last day of my stay, I bumped into Ricardo Santos, son of the president of Andorinha, Cristiano's first club. The same age, he had been a teammate of his, both at the club and in the street games. They were close friends. But, he insisted with a shy look, that part of his life means little to him now. On the way to the airport, I called Fernando Egidio, a well-known sociologist who lives in Funchal. He refused to speak about Ronaldo. He was not the only one. I got the feeling that many Madeirans have an excessive respect for the player, and even that he divides opinion. Of course, envy surrounds his achievements, but at first glance, there was minimal evidence of the almost religious devotion that many, for example, have for Lionel Messi in Rosario or Diego Maradona in Buenos Aires. Maybe that is just a reflection of the way football is experienced in each country. Cristiano, contrary to what some of his compatriots say, does care about Madeira and have real interest in what goes on there. He chose the island as the location of the first hotel in his CR7 chain, which opened in summer 2016. The next ones to open will be in Lisbon and Madrid. He has a house on the coast and has built another one nearby for his mother. He donated generously towards flood relief on the island in 2010, when excessive flooding caused 40 deaths and more than 100 injuries. Such involvement has helped his homeland, including free advertising campaigns, strengthen Madeira's position as a tourist destination. In December 2013, he opened a museum that houses 155 of his trophies and medals, 27 match balls signed by teammates after hat-tricks, and well-known photos that tell his story, or part of it at least. As the Daily Telegraph put it in an article in May 2014, Pele, the greatest of them all, needed three World Cups, 1,281 goals, and another 31 years after his career finished before anyone felt it necessary to open a museum in his name. The entrance, which boasts two sliding doors across which a larger-than-life photo of Ronaldo suddenly divides, leads the visitor into a thoroughly modern Aladdin's cave of a shrine, containing evidence of his greatest successes. As the Catalan poet Salvador Espriu said, the mirror of the truth is broken into minuscule fragments. All the 1,000 visitors that the museum welcomes in a typical week are delighted to buy one of those pieces, the one that recreates the fairy tale that the Ronaldo family want you to know. Espriu also said that each of the pieces contains a glimmer of light. Ronaldo's trophies are certainly real, but just as real is the difficult background that the Santos Aveiro family endured and ultimately overcame. Maria Dolores Aveiro was born in Canisal, Madeira, where life was tough in the 1950s. Her brother had been born a year earlier, but wasn't officially registered until the birth of Dolores. In poverty, official documentation is both a foreign language and a nuisance. From then on, Ronaldo's mother's story is marked by struggle, as is common in Madeira. It was an incessant battle to shape a destiny with the odds stacked against her from birth. Her own mother, Matilde, passed away when Dolores was 5 after suffering a heart attack at the age of 37. She left 4 children behind. There was little money for food or clothing. Motherly affection was missing, and so Dolores, the eldest sibling, took on from an early age the role that Matilde had left vacant. Her father, José Vivero, ended up sending the 4 siblings away to 2 different religious orphanages. Maria Dolores cried every day. The nuns ruled by corporal punishment, and Dolores was frequently chastised for minor infringements, like making spelling mistakes. She escaped from the orphanage on several occasions. Punishment, when she was caught, was severe. Her father did not visit her. Her principal motivation and driving force was to ensure her siblings were okay and reunited quickly. One day, José turned up with his new wife, Angela. The stepmother had 5 children of her own and was already pregnant with a 6th. When Maria Dolores turned 9, the nuns decided to give José an ultimatum regarding his bruise-covered daughter. He had to take her away, and so he did. Her stepmother beat her many times, and so she ran away. They tied her to the table legs so that she would not do it again. Domestic violence towards Dolores extended to her siblings. Her father decided to admit her to a mental hospital, but the psychiatrist told him that there was nothing wrong with his daughter. It was not his daughter who had a problem. Dolores thought about taking her own life. There was no water or electricity in José and Angela's house, which was inhabited by 12 people. 5 children slept in 1 room. Her father took her out of school at 13. School was for boys. She had to work and started making wicker baskets for the harvest. Work began at 5:30 in the morning, 6 days a week. When she was 18, Dolores met one of the good guys. She became friendly with a local boy, José Ginis Aveiro, 2 years older, who worked for a fishmonger. They would bump into each other when she went to the market or on their way home. He made her laugh. He was full of life, made her feel attractive and respected. She fell in love. When her father found out, he gave them a 3-month window in which to get married. One less mouth to feed, he thought. They married and moved in together at Ginis's parents' house, where all 4 of them slept in the same room with a curtain separating them. Time seemed to stand still, and Dolores experienced a tranquility that would provide her first taste of contentment. They did not have big plans, nor did they use contraception. Elma, their first child, arrived a year after the wedding. Dolores fell pregnant once again soon after, while still recovering from the birth of her first child. Their happiness would not last long, as Ginis was called up to the army. Angola, Guinea-Bissau, and Mozambique, all Portuguese colonies at the time, were fighting for independence, while Portugal was trying to retain her empire and economic interests. Hugo, the second child, was born while Ginis was in Africa, but something in Ginis seemed to die on the front line. He returned to his parents' home in Santo Antonio 10 months later, but was a greyer version. His demeanor portrayed a loss of joy. His smile had evaporated. He had aged 10 years rather than 10 months. He left his innocence and brightness behind on African soil, his head filled with images of war, as was the case with countless others. Ginis was mutilated by war, although his body remained unharmed. He was simply counting down the days until the end and lost his enthusiasm for everything and everyone, his wife included. Nothing could be done about it. He stopped working. From that point onwards, you could always find him in the same place from early morning onwards, in the bar. Now Dolores suddenly had to take on the role of father as well as mother. She went to France to work, emigrating alone, as many Madeiran men often did. If she could provide for all of them with her job as a housemaid in Paris, she would pay for them all to move to France. But what occurred was a new isolation, this time from her children and husband, who were being taken care of by her in-laws. In a rare moment of clarity, Denise said to her on the telephone, "If we were born to be poor, we will be. But be close to your children at the very least." She returned home 5 months later, and soon after became pregnant with Katia. Dolores was 22 at the time. After the Carnation Revolution and the end of Salazar's dictatorship in 1974, she occupied an abandoned house, as many others had done. Denise watched her run towards the new and half-abandoned property, with a child in her arms and the other two running behind. Everything seemed very distant to him, as if he were on the outside looking in. His anxiety was almost turning him into another child who needed to be looked after. He was still unemployed. He was just another man on the island lacking direction. At 30, Dolores fell pregnant once again. This time, it was very much unplanned. It was a nuisance. There was not enough food for everyone, and her husband was still absent. She thought about having an abortion. In fact, she did try to have one. A neighbor told her to drink boiled black beer and then run until being on the verge of fainting. It did not work. The doctor did not want to help her, seeing no reason for a termination. "It'll be the joy of the house," he told her. When the baby was born, he said, weighing that much, he could become a footballer. Dolores named him after the then president of the United States, Ronald Reagan. Cristiano Ronaldo dos Santos Aveiro was born on the 5th of February, 1985. Ronaldo was nearly born in Australia. José Viveiro, Dolores's dad, had seen many friends leave Madeira and had eventually decided to abandon the island himself and head to Perth with Angela and her children. Dolores tried to convince him to take the whole family. José replied that there was no room, as though Australia is small. José and Angela, who has since passed away, lived in Yanjibup, a suburb of Australia's fourth most populous city. Ronaldo paid for their accommodation and travelled to see him play in various matches during the 2006 World Cup in Germany, in which Portugal finished fourth. Dolores was their guide. Before we continue, there is one curious piece of biographical information worth recording. Ronaldo has African roots. Cristiano's paternal great-grandmother was Isabel Rosa Piedade, who was born in Praia, the capital of Cape Verde. At 16, she emigrated to Funchal, where she married José Aveiro. Isabel and José had a son called Umberto, José Genise's father and Cristiano's grandfather. That African heritage may explain part of his innate ability as a footballer. In short, the muscle fibre prevalent in black sprinters, white, type 2 for fast contractions, that produces energy quickly and explosively without requiring oxygen, is the very type that Ronaldo was born with. Back in the new, borrowed Aveiro household, everybody had to lend a hand. Elma and Hugo left school early to start working. She waitressed in a hotel restaurant while he worked for an aluminium company. They were not yet 17. Dolores also experienced a change as she replaced wicker baskets with a spoon. She now worked in the kitchen of a Funchal hotel, but they still had to count every penny. There was always bread on the table, and they had cold cuts every 2 weeks and meat on Sundays. The midweek menu consisted of a soup that Dolores prepared in the few hours she spent at home between work shifts, with bread and butter. Chicken was reserved for family celebrations. Nobody went hungry, though. They never bought clothes. Rather, they humbly accepted hand-me-downs from other families. When they outgrew them, cousins shared shirts, trousers, and even underwear with the Aveiro children. The family eventually moved to Quinta do Falcão, a village near the San Antonio Cemetery, and where social housing had been built for poor residents who had previously lived in shacks, well away from the area frequented by tourists. It was certainly an improvement, although the roofs were made of asbestos. They were not rainproof, which meant that Dolores had to ask the council for materials to strengthen them. The walls were unpainted brick and wooden slabs. "We had 3 rooms, one for me and my sister, one for Hugo and Cristiano, and one for my mother and father," Katia explained in a television interview. "It was a very humble home, but I remember it being very comfortable and we were happy there." In this typical poor village, where alcohol and drugs are omnipresent, children lived and played in the street, which was the playground for every house. Nobody, though, considered it a limitation. It never is when everyone is in the same situation. The house no longer exists, Katya said. When I go around that district, I always get goosebumps and would like to return to live one day. I know it isn't possible, but when I remember everything we went through there, words don't do it justice. The house was demolished in 2008, despite Ronaldo's rise to fame. No effort was made by anybody to retain it for posterity. It is now an esplanade covered in weeds. There are still high-rise buildings in Quinta do Falco, where Ronaldo still has aunts and uncles, and whose children once played in the street with him. And in one of them lived Filomena Aveiro, Cristiano's paternal grandmother until her final days. People walk in and out of houses without knocking. Nobody locks their doors. Ronaldo was born and grew up constantly surrounded by people, and that is how he has always lived. His houses in Manchester and Madrid have been guest houses for friends and family. The door is always open. There is a marvellous photograph of a 16-year-old Ronaldo wearing a sporting Lisbon shirt taken during a visit to Madeira. He went to Quinta do Falco and asked for it to be taken outside his old house. He was frowning and beaming with pride at the same time. Another emigrant making a name for himself in the capital city with the spectre of what he had left behind. It is the only snap from his first home. Nobody had thought about taking one there before. There is no decent place to kick a ball around in Quinta do Falco without bothering someone. No park, not even a suitable piece of waste ground. Marítimo, one of the more important clubs on the island, is just a 10-minute walk away. But in that district, the youngsters, unless they go a couple of miles away to the beach, have no choice but to play on the steep and uneven streets. Ronaldo's father arrived half an hour late for his own son's baptism. Diniz, who had played football as a child and had become the kit man at the modest local club Andorinha, decided that the team captain, Fernando Barros Sousa, should be the godfather. He thought of him as a good role model for Cristiano, a natural leader, and thanks to his business success, he seemed to have all the money he needed. The ceremony was at 6 o'clock, but Andorinha had a match at 4, meaning it was obvious that they would not make it, yet Diniz did not change the plan. He went to the match and could not be there in time for the baptism. The priest had to be calmed down. He had already christened the rest of the children. Only Cristiano remained, and no father present. If people around you are involved in football, if your role models are footballers, and if your father has the cheek to arrive late at your baptism because of a match, it is almost logical for you to end up becoming a footballer. A scene from the documentary Sir Novi Vivi Aki about Cristiano Ronaldo. After hearing the voice of Cristiano say, "I reached the top of the world, now I want to be eternal," you see him put on a child's voice, lean towards the computer screen, displaying a mosaic of passport photos of him as a baby, while saying something like, "T-T-T-T-T, Cristiano Ronaldo." He motions as if to caress the boy in the photo. He moves away and laughs. Ronaldo laughs a lot. Cristiano Ronaldo. "It's me, 3 months old. Look. Look at that boy, how cute, with a gold bracelet on my wrist." He then adopts a funny pose in which it is clear that he is laughing at himself, but he is not self-conscious about seeing himself. Meanwhile, his sister Katya holds her son. Ronaldo asks her, "Does he look like me?" The shot once again focuses on the photo of baby Cristiano with big alert eyes. He is not looking into the camera, but at somebody who presumably is saying something to him. Cristiano Ronaldo. "He'll be a footballer like his uncle." The baby starts crying, and Cristiano reassures his sister. Cristiano Ronaldo. "I was like that too. Don't worry." Katya used to take Cristiano to school and then wait for him so that they could go home together. She used to help him do his homework. As Maria Dolores could not be on top of everything, Katya quickly learned how to control her younger brother. "But he didn't pay much attention to me." Laughter. "No," she recalled. "I used to get annoyed with him all the time. My mother would say, 'Katya, when you're home, don't let Cristiano go out to play football till he finishes his homework.' We had a front and back door. I'd say to Ronaldo, at home we always called him Ronaldo, not Cristiano, 'Ronaldo, please do your homework.' 'Okay,' he would answer. When I called him, he was no longer there. Then my mother would be angry with me when she got home from work." He was a rebellious boy, but he also knew how to listen if you grabbed his attention. He would take notice of what you said. He was well behaved, says his mother now. He was actively involved whenever we did recreational activities at the end of each term, such as theatre, dance, singing, recalled Sister Grasa, a primary school teacher at the São João School in Funchal. Cristiano used to ask for starring roles, but he was quite lazy. He would forget about the household chores. I remember she would sometimes grab me by the ear and slap me on the hand, jokes Cristiano. I was a good boy because I was controlled by my mum, dad and older siblings. I think I was very hard working. Well, I think so anyway. Laughter. Ginice, the father. Ginice Avero had received no more than the obligatory education and, after his service in the army, had to try to earn a living by doing manual labour. After being employed as a fishmonger, he was a stonecutter and a council gardener, but spent more time unemployed than in work. So, when the opportunity to do odd jobs at 5th Division outfit Andorinha came up, he gratefully accepted. The club received grants from the council and today has a floodlit artificial pitch, but in the early days they had to play in rented pitches or at sports centres. Eventually, they got given a dirt field and a small bar and a storeroom were built. Ginice had to collect the equipment, look after the balls, get things ready for the coaches, prepare the kits, clean the toilets and cut the grass. Football's importance was gradually growing in the family as attending Andorinha matches became a regular activity, especially the ones played by the youth team, of which Hugo Avero was a member. Everyone says that José Ginice was a good bloke. He was popular, calm and had a deep, husky voice, and he spent what little money he had on drink. Many others, several war veterans among them, did the same, drowned in poverty, depressed, trapped by the sea and bored. People start drinking in the morning in Madeira, and they do not stop. They say it is a cultural thing like in Great Britain or the Nordic countries. The local beverage is a type of spirit mixed with honey and lemon, passion fruit or any other fruit, and is consumed hot. It was used by fishermen as a pick-me-up. It packs a punch. 2 glasses and you are well on your way. That is what people drink, and it is cheap, of course. Arnaldo, my guide on one of my trips to Madeira, told me that his father first gave him alcohol when he was 4. There was no juice in the bars, but there was a punch that he was given to keep him quiet while the men chatted and drank among themselves. He didn't say no to it, and drank it every time he was given it. Ginice was not one of those drunkards who demand attention or believed he was always right. He was polite and quiet as he whiled the hours away. Ronaldo, at 8 or 9, enjoyed being in his dad's company. Many evenings, the clock would strike 11 and Cristiano wanted to go to bed, but without his father home, he couldn't relax. He would go to the bar with his sister or a friend to pick him up, although Ginice was often reluctant to return home. He preferred to stay in his spot at the corner of the bar, quiet, drinking, without causing trouble, absorbed in his thoughts. When he was ready to go back home, he would walk with his arm around Cristiano's young shoulders. At such a young age, Ronaldo gradually took on the father figure role that his own father was neglecting. "I just want my son to be happy and successful," he was heard saying in the bar. "I personally want to live in my world. His world belongs to him." In fact, he did not like going to Manchester once Cristiano moved there, and only went a few times. My friend Moises would say that he was one of those men who was happy with a plate of green beans. In other words, he asked for little from life. Ginice initially refused his son's help when his health deteriorated. Ronaldo offered to pay for treatment at the most expensive clinics in England, but it was only towards the end that, to appease his son, Ginice relented. It was already too late. He passed away in a London clinic. His absence, lack of authority, bonhomie, and his faith in Ronaldo as a footballer have earned him a special place in his children's memories. In a way, he is almost worshipped. At Cristiano's house in Manchester, there were several photos of José Ginice Avero, and Katia's little boy is called Zé, the diminutive form of José, as a tribute to his grandfather. We discussed all this with Martinho Fernandes, a Madeiran journalist who was a friend of José Ginice. If Cristiano had stayed in Madeira, he would never have achieved what he has, he explained. He thinks that Ronaldo, like all of us, is the product of his upbringing. He came from a poverty-ridden, broken home, But maybe all that, or some of it, is necessary for an individual to become a success. His ability to overcome hurdles remains with him and helps him grow. Martino added something else. If your parents aren't too much on top of you, that freedom allows you to reach your potential. An interesting idea, the one about parents' influence, that came up in a number of conversations. Fernando Sousa, Ronaldo's godfather, never forgot his duties when it came to Christmas presents. One year, he bought his godson a toy car, and the boy threw a tantrum because he desperately wanted a football. But why? Especially as his father carried a huge bag of balls around every day, and little Cristiano often helped him collect them at the end of training. He, of course, wanted his own ball. Fernando took note and accordingly gave him one the following year. It cost a whopping €5. Young Cristiano took it with him everywhere. His neighbour, Adelilo Andrade, remembered him as a fairly short and skinny boy with curly dark hair who spent all day in the street with his ball. The kid would do all sorts of astonishing tricks with it. It seemed to be stuck to his feet. I've seen Ronaldo do numerous kick-ups with a plastic bottle lid, and then the bottle itself without either touching the floor. The conversation with the ball started there and then. When I was young, Ronaldo remembers, I used to enjoy watching the older guys showing off with a ball, and I would do the same. It soon became a regular hobby, playing with a football, doing new tricks in the street, in the warm-up, in training. He says that's the real Cristiano Ronaldo. He does not do it to show off, though. Not always, anyway. It is part of his relationship with his constant travel buddy. He used to go to class with a ball under his arm, too, even though one teacher in particular reminded him that a ball was not going to feed him. A ball wouldn't get him anywhere in life. School was where you laid the foundations that would one day allow you to reach your potential. She felt it was her obligation to remind the students the relevance of what they were learning, to emphasize the importance of education and put it into context, a perspective many of them didn't necessarily get from elsewhere. Nothing wrong with that. The teacher was, in fact, right to say it. But Ronaldo happens to be one of the notable exceptions that proves the rule. Yet she was left with no choice but to apologize repeatedly, as she has done to Cristiano's auntie and mother on various occasions. She said that she would not speak in such a way again. 12-year-old Ronaldo would think about those words when sitting on the plane to Lisbon for the first time. They had become a motivational weapon. The street match. Madeira, the island of eternal spring, is blessed with a constant temperature. It hardly ever goes above 33 degrees. Perfect conditions for playing in the street. The island was formed by volcanic eruptions, causing the ground to be uneven and the formation of cliffs and caves. Its mountainous terrain leaves room for very few planes. Far from the ideal scenario for a daily football match, Cristiano would return home from school, dump his rucksack anywhere, promise to do his homework, grab a yogurt, make a hole in the bottom of the pot and drink it while heading out of the back door and hearing his sister yell something about schoolwork. Two rocks served as goalposts on the steep and narrow street next to his house. A plastic bottle or a ball made from bags and paper were used. That is the magic of football. Everyone can play and no technology is needed. The rules are crystal clear too. When Ronaldo began receiving footballs as gifts, he always brought his own with him and they would play as long as he wanted. And the game that he wanted. The owner of the ball sets the rules. Those games started after school, and it was dark before they finished. Cristiano was the most competitive of the lot. The best. Buses and cars would go down there so frequently that the kids had to move the rocks, goalposts, to allow traffic to pass. There was time for 2 minutes of uninterrupted play at most. It was impossible to play the ball long in such a small space, so it was short passes all the way, or, in Cristiano's case, dribbling past everyone. His technique allowed him to do that and more. The unevenly paved street full of obstacles and the many hours of street football helped him develop it. If nobody turned up, Ronaldo would take the ball to a small field and shoot against a wall, again and again for hours and hours. Or he would go down to the beaches in search of new challenges. Regulars included his friend Ricardo Santos, whose father was the Andorinha president, and who now oversees the day-to-day running of the club as sporting director. The competitive spirit found in street football gives you that swagger and confidence. Or, as Nuno Luz, journalist and friend of Ronaldo, says about anyone growing up on the street. In a poor village, you have no choice but to have character. If you don't, they eat you up. Either you step on them or they step on you. No one ever stepped on Ronaldo. When I joined Andorinha at 9 years old, he was already there, recalled Ricardo. And when we started playing for the club, we didn't play in the street as much. What psychologists call deliberated game, the football played on the streets without many rules or timetables, was replaced at Andorinha between the ages of 8 and 10 by deliberated training. Football with kits, cones on the ground, stretching and coaches. Cristiano was surrounded by familiar faces. His dad, seeing the hours he spent playing in the street with the ball, suggested he should join him at the club where he worked as a kitman. And when he did, Ronaldo would bring his ball with him. His cousin Nuno, who played for the club, had invited him to one training session, after which he was asked to return. His brother Hugo was still playing in a higher age group. Ricardo Santos, initially reserved and even dismissive of that time, gradually opened up as we walked around the club's modest facilities. He was here for 2 seasons, but he was mainly playing with kids 2 or 3 years older. We kept an early registration form for him. It's from 94 to 95. We used to play on dirt pitches, and he was clearly the best. He was a striker and was everywhere. He liked driving forward, dribbling and doing stepovers. He hasn't changed much. In the first few weeks, Ronaldo kept to himself. He, in fact, was afraid to get the ball. Everybody seemed twice his size, but he didn't need much time to develop relationships with the other kids to show his playful side. They used to call him Noodle because he was not particularly tall and very thin. Fear soon gave way to confidence. We didn't think he was weak, Ricardo remembered. He didn't need any protection against the older boys, for example. He could look after himself. Midweek training involved 3-on-3 matches. It was 7-a-side on Saturdays, and Ronaldo would ask to play in 11-a-side games on Sundays. You could see that he was fantastic in small spaces, very fast, and had enviable technique with both feet, rare for someone his age. He didn't need to come to Andorinha to learn ball control techniques, how to dribble or do tricks, said Francisco Alonso, a teacher at his school and one of his first coaches. Maybe it's innate. Many legendary matches live long in the memory. One day, Andorinha were winning 3-0 when Cristiano went down and had to be taken off after a clash of heads. The team caved in and lost 4-3. He was already that important to his side. Another day, he went into the dressing room in tears because his side was losing. A 2-0 half-time deficit was transformed into a 3-2 victory when Ronaldo began to dominate the ball and single-handedly turned the game on its head. His teammates called him Crybaby. He cried and cried, not just in the dressing room, but also on the pitch if the team was losing. He would cry very easily. Also, when he passed to his teammates and they failed to score, that made him cry too, and angry. Yes, at 8 he already showed his frustration if they didn't pass to him, and the other boys answered him back, recalled Ricardo Santos. As a kid, I got so annoyed when we lost, Cristiano says. Every defeat is like a small loss of life for boys like him. Failure has no place, nor has doubt. Only goals and victories are acceptable. The rest is inconceivable, inadmissible. His teammates also called him the little bee for his insect-like speed. The first trophy that 8-year-old Ronaldo won as player of the tournament in a local competition sits proudly in his museum in Funchal. While we were speaking, a pot-bellied man took the rubbish out and prepared to take it to a skip, the same job Janice used to do. He chatted to everybody and finally sat down with customers at the bar to have a small beer. Ricardo asked him to take a ball out so that I could take a staged photo and also so he could show me something they fondly keep, the photo of Ronaldo with his team, his father on one side, tall and proud. Years later, Ronaldo invited Ricardo and his father to Manchester to visit him at his house and watch a Manchester United game. It was the penultimate time that Cristiano saw his former teammate. The last one was during the inauguration of the Ronaldo Museum in Funchal, although then they exchanged nothing but a simple, "How's everything going?" "I'd feel embarrassed to speak to him now beyond polite pleasantries," admits Ricardo. Andorinha wanted Cristiano to be the patron of their academy, but the star demurred. A club director had, at some stage, given an interview to the local paper, Abola, in which he had made less than complimentary remarks about Ronaldo's mother. Since then, Ronaldo has distanced himself from his first club. Physical education was his favourite. It was clear to see. He was always picked for activities that required maximum coordination, remembered Irma Grassa, one of his teachers. That coordination made him good at everything. Tennis, pool, table tennis. It also gave him the excuse to be away from books. I dreamed about having a son who played football because I loved the sport, revealed Dolores, a fan of both Luis Figo and Sporting Lisbon. Sometimes Ronaldo missed class to play. His teacher told me that I should tell him off for that, but I didn't punish him. He had to practice a lot to become a great player. Ronaldo, the youngest sibling, has always had a strong bond with his mother. When he started creating two different paths in his life, "Mum, either I go to school or to football," she knew how she had to respond. "If football is what you like, son, go ahead." Cristiano was laying waste to everyone in his path at Andorinha, and word soon reached the Nacional youth team coach. What happened next was a moment of farce. Having been informed of the fledgling talent, the coach went to see him play. I was hugely surprised to discover that he was my godson. I knew he played football, but I didn't know how good he was. He was streets ahead of the rest, declared his godfather, Fernando Barroso Sousa, a crucial figure in Cristiano's early big decisions. 10-year-old Cristiano moved to CD Nacional a few months later in the autumn of 1995. But why join Nacional when Marítimo, the other big club on the island, had a better reputation for bringing youngsters through and were one of the five or six biggest clubs in the country? In 1994-95, they had become the in team after surprisingly reaching the cup final, and furthermore, it was next door to Andorinha. Marítimo appealed more to Ronaldo and to Ginis. The ground was nearby, and it seemed to be the logical next step for the boy. Andorinha's financial demands made the Marítimo president, who did not appreciate the player's value at the time, break off negotiations. Cristiano's godfather had begun talks with Nacional, and when they found out that Marítimo were out of the bidding, they took the necessary steps to seal the deal. Two sets of kits and 20 footballs was the price that his new club had to pay. Or so the story has been told many times over. But there is something missing from this story about the boy who proudly wore the Marítimo colours and yet was lost to their greatest rivals, Nacional. The fact is that, but for a quirk of fate, Bernardino Rosa, the poorly paid head of recruitment at the Marítimo Academy, could have changed Ronaldo's destiny and perhaps even football history. But Bernardino was late for a meeting. Marítimo had a close relationship with their neighbour Andorinha, lending them balls, bibs, kit. As the modest team that they were, Bernardino knew that it would be in Ronaldo's best interests to move to the Marítimo Academy with its better facilities and better prospects. It seemed like a natural progression. In the latter part of the 20th century, falling birth rates were beginning to affect the talent pool of young players. In the 1970s, the annual birth rate on the island.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.